Okay, I guess it's time to start. So, thanks for coming today. Today we have a very, very interesting topic, genetic programming by Vish from the Department of Chemistry. I don't want to try to pronounce the rest of your name. But despite the complex nature of the subject matter, at the end he's going to show you a very nice tool that's broadly applicable to a lot of your research, which is finding model equations to fit data, which is very difficult. So, without further ado, here's Vish.
Thanks for the intro. So as my title suggests, this is about genetic programming. And before I take you through the slides, my plan is to give you kind of a general introduction to what is known as nature-inspired algorithms. And then I have a few example cases where we apply genetic programming. And finally, I'll do a kind of a short demo using the software called Eureka. But first and foremost, we have this problem of optimization, and which, as you all very well know, is the idea of finding the best solution for a given problem. Now, in most cases, you would be familiar with gradient descent algorithms, which will work very well for functions that are quite smooth or unimodal. But what you will generally also see in real-world scenarios, that most functions can also be multimodal. They can be quite discontinuous and highly nonlinear. So for problems such as those, you would need slightly different set of tools. So as a highly nonlinear problem, I have an example here. So the map here is the map of the US, as you are already familiar. So our starting point is Chicago. And these two guys have to start from Chicago and travel to every other city in the US exactly once, as in touching every city exactly once, but with the provision that the total cost of their travel should be minimized. Now, if you had to just traverse three or four cities, you could actually apply a brute force algorithm. So you would end up with 3 factorial or 4 factorial different combinations. But if your number of cities grows, you would automatically see that you would need significantly more time to solve the problem. Now, these kinds of combinatorial optimization problems are generally classed as NP-complete or non-deterministic polynomial-based algorithms. And for problems such as these, you actually have no known feasible exact solution methods. To give you a slightly broader perspective on optimization problems, one of the standard problems is of job scheduling, where if you have, say, n jobs and m machines, we are asked to allocate these n jobs to those m machines with the constraint that the overall processing time for all the jobs should be as small as possible. Now, this is basically because you have every job which takes different amount of time. If we move into biology, we have the protein folding problem. So if you've heard of the IBM machine called Blue Gene, it's devoted its resources to solving this protein folding problem. And the problem of protein folding is to identify the three-dimensional structure of the protein given a sequence of amino acids. Now, the same applies if you are trying to solve the biostable complex of a protein and ligand. And in both cases, what you will generally see that we have a very vast landscape. Energy landscape is quite big, and we have multiple minima in those landscapes. Moving on further to finance, we have a highly nonlinear data. So we have also a set of parameters that are constantly changing, and we have additional multiple constraints. So for example, in portfolio management, we are trying to maximize our investments while minimizing the risk. So for solving problems such as these, you would have to look for something that is slightly different. So if you were to look at nature, we as organisms are constantly evolving with regard to some changing environmental conditions. So in these changing environmental conditions, we have multiple variables. These are quite, these are dynamic as well. And the way we adapt to these changing conditions is through a process of adaptation, wherein we use the concept of feedback. So for a given action, we get a response and use that to learn how to acclimatize ourselves to these changing conditions. Now, this adaptability, of course, ensures that we can survive and move further on. So why not use this concept of nature, or channelize this concept in nature, into a set of algorithms that can be formulated into several different mathematical formulations here. So you have algorithms based on ant colonies, bee swarms, and on the side you have algorithms based on simulated annealing or artificial immune systems and so on. So in the case of artificial immune system, we're basically using the concept that our body is able to build up an immune response to several different pathogens that attack our body. And simulated annealing, we are using the concept of the cooling of a metal to translate that into a mathematical formulation. So in all cases, as you can see, we are trying to emulate a process in nature and use that into a mathematical construct. So to give you a slightly different idea, we have here an anthill. And each ant here is basically taking a slightly different path to what it considers to be a food source. Now, ants basically communicate with each other using a concept called stigmergy. And what they actually do is to leave a chemical, which is known as a pheromone, along each path. Now, there are certain paths that will be frequently traversed. And on these paths, you will find larger concentrations of pheromone. So by using this approach, ants are actually able to find the shortest path to their food source, which is something you could actually apply to our first problem that I showed in the slide. Moving on further to the concept of nature-inspired algorithms, these are stochastic approaches, so in the sense that they have a random element associated with them. And because of this randomness, there's no guarantee that when you apply these approaches, you're actually going to find the solution that you are looking for. But in most of the cases, they are more or less going to work. The best advantage here is that you can actually find some quality solutions in time frames that you determine to be acceptable. But how does it carry out the search? Well, if you've heard of crowdsourcing, that's basically what nature-inspired algorithms also do. So they have a crowd of solutions, or potential solutions, and these solutions basically span the search space. And to try and improve these solutions, it uses a heuristic, which is basically a trial and error approach, and iteratively tries to refine the solutions. And this process is done via two methods. One is basically exploration, which is guaranteeing that the search space is basically being searched or is being traversed as widely as possible. And the second one is exploitation, where once having found a decent solution, you try kind of tweaking it locally and see if you can improve the solution ever so little. So there's, of course, a trade-off between how much you want to explore and how much you want to exploit. So this, of course, is the general trends that you would follow in any nature-inspired algorithm. Now, coming back to the same slide, you'll see that this is basically not a complete list, but there are several different algorithms such as these. The immediate question that you would then ask is, why do you have so many algorithms? And if given a problem, which one do I choose? We don't have an easy answer for that, but you can always quote the no free lunch theorem, or NFL for short, which says that if you were to apply these algorithms to several different problems, you would see that some algorithms work for some cases really well, and for some others, they are just about decent. So in short, there is no algorithm that's superior to all the others on all the problems. And the reason this happens is because these algorithms tend to use different parameters. They have different ways of representing your problem. And at the same time, they have different search strategies. So when you apply any of these algorithms, there is, again, the trade-off that you will have to live with. So for example, if you are looking for efficiency, you might have to sacrifice the applicability of these algorithms to the problems that you want to apply it to. Or if you're looking for highly reliable solutions, then you would have to expend more computational time to solve and get the solution that you're looking for. Now, there's another class of algorithms that I haven't shown in the previous slide, and those are what we call evolutionary algorithms. And if you were to search in the ISI Web of Science, you would find in the past 20 or 25 years, we've had more than 40,000 publications with the theme evolutionary algorithms. And going further, if you look at the subject areas, you would see that they span several different sections, starting from biology, medicine, and allied fields to even places like anthropology, paleontology, and so on. So what exactly are these evolutionary algorithms? So if you are familiar with Darwin's theory of evolution, the evolutionary algorithm is simply a computational realization of that very theory. So we have, for our problem, a population, which is basically our crowdsourcing concept. So each member in this population is going to be assigned a certain fitness, and we indicate this fitness to be a quality, as in a figure of merit associated with that solution. And each member of this population will basically compete for what's known as to be a member of a mating pool. And so this competitive process of competitive selection process will select some members of your original population. And those members will then undergo what's known as recombination mutation. And this is simply an exchange of your genetic material. The new offspring that are formed from this process undergo again the evaluation phase. And this is repeated over several different cycles. The iterative process essentially means that we are hoping all the beneficial traits that are found in our ancestors will be provided to the progeny as well. And as the iteration proceeds, it will converge to a solution that you are looking for. Under the umbrella of evolutionary algorithms, you have several different variants. And the top two are the most popular ones. The other two, again, will change depending on what kind of recombination and mutation you apply and what kind of search strategies you might want to use. So the algorithmic steps, again, to kind of refamiliarize you with the concept, we have an objective function. So this could be, for instance, something that you wish to minimize or maximize. And this function is basically the one that will give you the concept of a fitness for each solution that you have. And we start at generation zero, where we build an initial population of B solutions. So this could be, say, 100 or 200, or as many as you require. And for each member of that population, we're going to calculate the fitness, which is basically the measure of the quality of your solutions. We then perform a competitive selection process, whereby we, say, select some 10 individuals from this population. And to all those 10 members, we could either apply a mutation or we use those members to perform some kind of recombination. This will result in new offspring. And so using this new set of members, you can create a new population. And sometimes you can also take a certain percentage of your previous population and copy it to the next one. And this is generally done so that you don't lose out on the good quality solutions that you have already discovered. You then go on to the next iteration, and this is done for as long as you are free to do so, or you end up with a fitness that you find is acceptable. So how do I apply these genetic operators of recombination and mutation? So I have here a potential solutions, which is indicated by P1 and P2. And each member is actually represented as a simple bit string. So you just have ones and zeros in this case. And I've color-coded these sections. So if you were to look at child one, what you generally see is that P1 and C1 actually share 50% of their DNA. The other 50% of the DNA actually comes from P2. Likewise, for C2, you see 50% of the DNA is from P2, and the other 50% from P1. So by doing just a swapping of the bit strings, you have actually achieved a crossover. Now, if you were to do mutation, we simply flip the bits. So we change 1 to 0 and 0 to 1, and we have mutated the string. And in doing so, you have actually now come up with three new individuals, or three new potential solutions. Now, coming to the problem of selection, now, as I mentioned, the fitness for each individual is a measure of its quality. Now, this fitness also determines who gets selected for crossover and mutation. Now, if you were to do this randomly, as in randomly select any member of the population, every member would have an equal chance of participating in the crossover and mutation process. But we generally don't do that, simply because we try to aim for the survival of the fittest. And so we have two standard selection strategies. The first one being roulette wheel, or which is also called fitness proportionate selection. And in this case, what we do is to normalize the fitness values. So whatever the fitness numbers that you get, you simply scale them so that they happen to be between 0 and 1. Once you do that, you can map it to your pi. And as you can see here, there are some members which actually have a higher cross-section of the pi. And this is because they have a higher fitness. So the higher the fitness, the greater the contribution to the pie chart. And if you spin the wheel, at some point it will land against the pointer. And invariably, you will see that the high fitness individuals tend to get selected often. And because of that, you actually move towards some kind of elitist selection strategy. And to avoid that, we have a second scheme called tournament selection, wherein we hold multiple tournaments. So suppose you wanted to select 10 members for the mating pool, you would have 10 such tournaments. And in each tournament, you would have, let's say, 2 or 3 players. So in this case, let's say if you took 2 players, which are selected randomly from this pool, we would hold a competition between them. In this case, a competition is simply a measure of who has the higher fitness. And the winner is then added to the mating pool. And this is done repeatedly till you have satisfied the number of individuals required for your selection or your crossover and mutation process. Now, coming to the real part of this talk, which is genetic programming. Now, genetic programming is simply put an automated invention strategy for creating programs. Now, these programs could be snippets of code that you could write in Java, C++, Python, and whatnot. Or you could also think of those programs as mathematical expressions. And in general, genetic programming can be used to perform some kind of system identification. Now, to make these executable codes or mathematical expressions, we're going to use a slightly different representation of the problem. And this is typically known as a parse tree structure, which is indicated here. Now, the circles in blue here are known as the functions. So these are your mathematical operators that you would apply. For instance, you could have plus, minus, sine, cos, tan, etc. Or you could use also if-then-else clauses. And the ones in yellow here, which are A, B, C, and the number 3, are typically known as the terminals. They are also called terminals because you can't extend the tree beyond this point. Now, for example, we have a 3-variable equation, which is very simply put A plus B plus C by 3. And if you were to look at this tree, you would see that the plus operator here is actually at the top. And when we look at this notation here, which is known as a prefix notation, we also see that all the operands are basically preceded by an operator sign. So we have plus followed by this branch, and again followed by this branch. So this notation is typically called a prefix notation. And I'll show you how to build this. So out of the pool that we have, as in plus, minus, and so on, we can randomly select a certain function. So in this case, I've selected the plus operator. And for the plus operator, you have 2 branches, or 2 arguments. So we'll select the first argument, which is again a random process. And in this, again, we end up with a plus operator, which again will have 2 branches. So we select the first operator for that, and we end up with A. Now, this is basically what we call the left-hand side of the branch. So to complete the right-hand side, we again end up selecting a terminal variable. And as you can see, there can be no further extension beyond this because we have terminated it. Now, traversing up the tree again, we start with the right-hand side of this branch. And this time, I've chosen a division operator, which again would have two operands. And randomly selecting those, we end up with CN3. And this is basically back to your equation that you saw on the previous slide. Now, with this kind of a tree structure, you can actually perform mutation and crossover quite easily. So for instance, I've randomly selected a particular node here. So in this case, C. Now I can change this to another terminal. So I can change it to D, for instance. Or I can change it to a constant, so 3 or 4, whatever. Or I can actually change it to a function. So in this case, I've chosen to convert it to a function. And I've chosen the modulus operator. The modulus operator, as you all are aware, also has two operands. So I've randomly chosen D and 2. So going from this, we have actually come up with a new equation simply by mutating. Now, this can also be done with regard to crossover. So in crossover, we are simply grafting. So we have two parents here, and I've selected this node and this node for the crossover. And as you can see, this is the first parent, and this is the first child. And they share almost all the DNA except this part. Now, this part here is actually coming from this parent. And in this case, this part is coming from this parent. So this is a very simple example of how we would do crossover. We're just taking one branch from one of the parents and grafting it onto the other. And in doing so, we've actually now come up with two new equations. So this is practically what we do when we are trying to do our equation discovery. Now, as I mentioned, you could also represent if-then-else rules. So this is a very simple example of if-then-else. You can also have for loops, while loops, and so on. So in this case, for the if then else, you have basically got three operands, in the sense that you have the if condition. And once that is satisfied, you have the then condition. And if this fails, you basically go for the else. So this tree here can be simply written as if square root of d minus c is less than 4, we print a, else we print b by e. So this is one of the simplest examples. But as I mentioned, you can have for loops, while loops, and so on. Now, coming to the examples, so this is actually an example which I had to do in terms of an article some 15 years back. And the idea here was to create a model that could predict the activity of that compound in terms of binding with thrombin, which is actually a very important receptor in blood clotting. So the data that was given to us was actually from the Knowledge and Data Mining Cup held way back in 2001. And the data was given in terms of two sets. So we had a training set and a testing set. So the training set here comprised of around 2,000 compounds. And for each compound, we were given over 100,000 features. So these features could represent any kind of chemical characteristic about for that compound. And for, again, for each compound, we were also told whether that compound was actually active or inactive. And in all cases, the numbers were thresholded such that you would actually get either a 0 or a 1. So all the data was effectively binary. Now, if you look at, have a closer look at this data, what you'll also see is in addition to the huge dimensions, we have a second problem, which is to do with the skewness of the data. So for the training set, we had this issue of the number of actives versus the number of inactives was like a huge 1:44. And for the test set, it was significantly reduced to 1:3. So our first problem was to try and fix the dimensionality of the problem. And second was to find a model that can actually fix this skewness issue as well. So in the first case, I use what's known as an information theoretic measure called mutual information. And by mutual information, we are trying to identify the very features that are fairly well correlated with the activity that we are looking at. And we then use genetic programming to try and build a model that can predict, given these features, the activity of the compound. So if I were to put it into a matrix, you would basically have these feature sets or the columns, and some function of these columns which actually relate to the activity of interest. So as I said, there are several different parameters when you specify a genetic programming episode. So in this case, we have the terminal set. So the terminal set are basically the set of features, and I've just called them A, B, C, D, and I've chosen the top 50 features that I found to be ranked according to the mutual information. The second part is basically the function set. Now, because the data is binary, I can actually use logic gates. So I've chosen three logic gates, AND, XOR, and NOT. Now, the AND function is just like a product function. So as you can see here, any multiplication of any number which doesn't contain a 1 effectively leads to 0. The NOT is simply a negation. So if you have 0, you simply put a 1, and so on. XOR is the only form which is slightly nonlinear, where you have 0 and 1, or 1 in either of those columns, it gives a 1 in the answer. So the idea is to try and evolve a set of solutions based on a connected set of logic gates and see if we can predict the activity. So without much ado, I came up with a 4-variable model. So out of the 100,000 variables, we just found 4 variables to be actually influencing the activity, which is basically your Y. And for this 4-variable model, we were also asked to calculate a balanced accuracy, the reason being you have an imbalance in terms of the actives and inactives. So when you multiply this by 0.5, effectively what you're trying to say is that you are measuring a balanced accuracy number. And this is basically the model that I could find that seemed to be the best. So in this case, we basically had around 71% accuracy, which is slightly only or marginally better than some of the other approaches, which are typically classed as machine learning approaches. And this is your standard tree representation of the genetic program that we found to be interesting. Moving on, we can also use genetic programming for molecular discovery. But in this case, what we're trying to do is to try and find molecular structures that have high properties or significantly improved property. So for instance, you could be improvising on terms of the pKa, or you could be focusing on the refractive index, or in other cases, simply lowering the toxicity of the molecule. Now, in terms of the genetic tree representation, we use a similar one. So instead of the functions and alphabets that you saw, we simply replace them with fragments or atoms. So any kind of change to this structure would simply mean that you are swapping this fragment with something else. So instead of a benzene, you can have something like a hydrogen, simply reducing the molecular weight, and so on. Now, we use this approach to identify ruthenium-based catalysts. And in this case, we use the fitness function, which is to do with the catalytic efficiency here. And it was called productivity because the productivity is something like an energy barrier that can be calculated from using quantum chemistry. The challenge, of course, is that quantum chemistry can be quite slow. So you can also use statistical models if you so choose. But in the end, we were actually able to identify new structures that can be potentially synthesized with significantly higher catalytic efficiencies. Now, has anybody heard of regular expressions here? Yes. Well, if you have tried filling forms online, normally you would be asked to specify an email address and a phone number. And if you were to enter it wrongly, you would see something in red complaining you have not filled the right information. And what internally the browser or the server is doing is to actually look for a certain sequence of characters. So for instance, in your email address, all email addresses should have an @ sign followed by a dot. If you are checking for numbers, you would simply say whatever you have entered should have only the digits 0 to 9. So these are standard examples of what we call regular expressions. Now, writing a regular expression, unfortunately, is not easy. But we could actually use genetic programming to do that as well. So there's a website, and I'll show it to you slightly later. Meanwhile, the main purpose of genetic programming is actually to do some kind of equation discovery. Now, this is a paper that was published in Science some 7 years back. And the idea here was to use what's known as symbolic regression, which is basically what you were doing in some of the previous slides. So they were trying to identify new equations. And by just simply perturbing those equations in terms of crossover and mutation, they were able to identify new Hamiltonians or Lagrangians and actually fit them to existing physical laws. Now, we're going to be seeing an example of this in due time. But before I go into the demonstrations, I'd like to also show you some software that's available for you to use. So Eureka is a software I'm going to demonstrate. It has actually a free academic license. But it also has APIs for Python and MATLAB if you plan to use them. Some of the other software, of course, is quite commercial. And if you want to actually end up writing your own program, there are several different libraries that you could make use of. So for the example that I had in mind, we have the software called Eureka. And first, I'm going to demonstrate to you how it can discover the Pythagoras theorem. So as you can see here, the y value is basically just a square root of x1 and x2. So I've already done those calculations before, and I've provided this as a data to the program. And my hope is to actually discover the Pythagoras theorem given the data. So this is your data input phase. You basically have kind of a data reprocessing phase as well. You can skip this because the data is fairly steady. And you need to first explain as to what are the variables. So in this case, we are basically saying that y is a function of x1 and x2. So you enter the values here. And as you can see in this particular space, you have several different operators. You have addition, subtraction, division, multiplication, and so on. You even have options such as sine, cos, and so on. Now, these are basically your functions, as I mentioned in the slide. And x1 and x2 are your terminals, or the variables. Now, to keep things simple, I'm going to remove some of these options. So I'm going to remove division. I'm going to remove sine, cosine. And I'm going to add just another operator called square root. So you have basically three variables here. The variables x, and you have basically got plus, multiply, and square root. So using these three functions, we are going to try and see if we can discover the Pythagoras theorem. Now, the other thing is also to do with the fitness. So you can have a selection of fitnesses here. So you can either optimize the R square, which is the squared correlation coefficient, or you can choose to minimize the squared error. In this case, I'm going to try and stick to the absolute error as an example. And we'll see if it can discover the solutions. So the solutions here are the ones that are being regressed against. So this is what we call our symbolic regression. And as you can see, the mean absolute error is reasonably decreasing, and it has almost come down to zero.
It went right to it there.
Yeah, that's the thing. So
it didn't do that in the test.
Yeah.
It took a while.
Yeah.
Got lucky there.
So as you can see, it's basically reached the solution in almost two or three steps. So this is one of the examples which works well, given that I have already supplied square root as one of the functions. Now, we can go back and remove square root, and you will see whether it can discover the same formula. Now, instead of the square root, this time I'll basically say you'll use a power function. And the chances are it will not, because it is heavily dependent also on the kind of function operators that you supply. So as you can see, it's actually just wobbling around. So in the previous instance, it almost discovered it within a couple of seconds. In this case, it's taking a wee while, but the chances are it may not actually come up with the convergence in as many iterations. So genetic programming sometimes can be quite painstaking. So I'm not going to let this run forever, but I'm going to stop this and I'm going to move to my next example. Now, this is an example I took from a paper published in the Journal of Physical Chemistry B. And the idea here is to model the melting point of anionic liquids. And the anionic liquids are basically a combination of cations and anions. And for these anionic liquids, we have got five different variables. So these are symmetry factors, molecular radius, and so on. And this paper here reported an equation correlating the melting point with these five factors. And it turns out that it managed to get an R squared of around 0.8 and a mean error of 25 degrees based on 67 anionic liquids. So we're going to try and see if we can reproduce either the same result or improve this. Not even close, yes. So it does depend significantly on the choice of your operators.
What if you took the whole enchilada and put all the functions in for the Pythagorean?
We could.
Exponential, everything.
Yeah, we could actually do that.
Would that take longer than two?
there's no guarantee it will find still the same solution in as many of these things, but it will try. But that's something you can actually try and play with and see. So for this second example, I have a new data set, which as you can see here, so the first column is the melting point, and I have called all the other five variables as A, B, C, D, E, just to make things easier for me to decide. And so it complains about the data being normalized or not normalized. You can either do that or forego it. And our equation here is basically the melting point is a function of A, B, C, D, and E. Now again, I'm going to use different operators to see if it can come up with the same solution. So this time I've chosen the addition, subtraction, multiplication, followed by division. Now, the numbers you see here alongside are basically a complexity penalty. And the reason why they do it is basically to find solutions that are simpler to understand. So, for instance, if you've heard of Occam's razor, the aim is to find a solution that is quite simple. So, if you had two solutions which are equally or performing equally, you would choose the one that seems simpler. So, this complexity here is basically one of the other parameters that this program tries to optimize. So in addition to the mean error or mean squared error, it's also trying to reduce the complexity of your solutions. So in this case, I'm going to try and use the squared error. So the mean squared error is something I'm going to try and reduce. And so as you can see here, it's basically gone through quite a few generations, which is basically your iterative process. And the mean squared error basically has come down from, say, 1700 or so to around 1100. This will, of course, go on. And as you can see, there are several different combinations of variables and numbers that it is attempting in the search for a solution that seems probable. Now, if you were to look at, so this is the current fit that it has managed to achieve. And this will, of course, improve over time. And further on, so this is the best result it has so far achieved, which, as you can see, is a fairly complicated equation. So this is basically what genetic programming is trying to do. It's trying to discover the relationship between the variables given the data that you have and a fitness, which is basically either a mean squared error or square correlation, whatever that it is that you're trying to optimize or minimize. Now, I'll let this run for a while. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we have an example, which is to try and evolve regular expressions. So there's this website, which you can try later on. I've chosen their example here. And if we had to look at the data here, what we have is a code or a set of instructions written in LaTeX. And we are trying to identify all the cases that are basically some kind of equations. So in LaTeX, we precede every mathematical symbol with a dollar and also end with a dollar. And all the highlighted sections are the ones we want to try and put it into some kind of searchable pattern. So as you can see here, in the first case, you have 13 such instances, and in the second one, 15. So we want to try and create a regular expression that can actually recognize that pattern. I simply said hit evolve, and as you can see, it goes through a certain set of series of changes. And over time, it will try and optimize the hit rate of how many instances it has managed to actually identify. Now, coming back to, again, our other case, where, as you can see, it has more or less stagnated for quite some time. So genetic programming also has a problem that it can actually hit a kind of a flat line, wherein it can't improve the solution after a certain set of iterations. So this is also probably a good point where we can stop the iteration and say we'll try a new set of functions or operators. I'll let this basically run for what it is worth and basically conclude my talk with the last slide, which is basically some reading material that you could enjoy at your leisure. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Vish. Does anyone have any questions? Yes, Baki.
Thank you, very interesting talk. Can you actually also find out differential equations?
Yes, you can. Yeah,
okay.
You can.
Cool.
Using the same software.
All right.
Yeah.
This Eureka software is also for Linux, or?
Yes, yes.
Do you have any way of doing cross-validation or anything?
Yes, it actually does cross-validation internally.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it does it. So you can actually change the percentage of the samples that are going to be used for training and testing.
But the score that you were showing us was over the full data set there.
Yes, but it actually reports the results on the cross-validated portion. Well, yes and no would be the answer, for the simple reason that it depends on how difficult your problem is and what dimensions your problem has. So for instance, in this case, the genetic programming works reasonably well for, let's say, up to 10 to 20 dimensions. And beyond that, any other method is just as good.
When it's like stagnating, mm-hmm. could you incorporate something that breeds in new?
It's a good question that you asked that. So what we can do is basically stop the search for now and go back to our search parameters and modify, say, add a new parameter, for instance.
Okay.
So we could add exponential. You can add anything that you feel would actually help the case. And the reason I do that is also because it basically says then, asks you whether you want to resume from the previous thing. So it basically has some kind of background knowledge which it can use to try and see if it can identify new solutions given the new information that it has.
And how do you limit the complexity of the tree, the depth?
The thing is, this program here actually has a trade-off between complexity of the solution. So the complexity generally is, in this case, an addition of all these numbers you have here. So it's like, for instance, you have, if you were to use sine, cosine, or tangent, or any of the trigonometric terms, it has an associated complexity of 3. So the more the number of times you end up using sine, cos, or tan, the complexity increases for the solution. But then it says, I have a solution which has basically got a high complexity but also has a fairly good performance. I have another solution which has a low complexity but has just about an average performance. The choice is then left to you whether you want the low complexity solution or the high complexity solution.
Okay, but you can tune that.
Yeah, you can tune that. So these numbers here can actually be changed as well. So these numbers are simply predefined. You can actually change them to 1 if you think it doesn't matter how complex the solution is. I don't care whether it's a sine, cos, tan, so long as I get an answer that seems logical.
Did it get better?
No. Good question. No, it's probably just stuck in, you'll have to let it run for quite some time. My only problem is my machine gets heated up quite a bit, so I tend to run it on a bigger machine.
Can you offload that to a cluster?
Yes. So you have basically got a secure cloud. So you can actually do it using the cloud services. You can actually use the APIs and do the calculations yourself on any cluster of those. Yeah. So it's better to use the API then if you want to do some of these calculations.
All
right.
GPU?
Pardon?
GPU calculation?
No. Well, it depends on whether it's configured for GPU. From what I think, I don't think it is. That is the case.
Okay, anybody else with some questions? I think that was a fruitful discussion. Thank you again, Vish.
Thank you.